Hello, folks. My name is George Griffin, and I was born here in Cheshire in 1815. As my family was of modest means, I was still wet behind the ears when I began work as a common laborer, farm work at first. But then I became a mason's apprentice, and I learned the trade of building structures out of stone, brick, and mortar. In 1840, when I was 25, I completed my apprenticeship. I married my sweetheart, Sarah Baldwin. We settled down, started a family. We were happy. I have to tell you about my son, George. Georgie, we called him. He was a good boy, a church-going boy. He honored and cherished his mother. And me, he'd follow me so closely, I took to calling him my shadow. What a joy it was watching Georgie grow. He was about to turn 18 in the spring of 1861 when the Civil War broke out. That wasn't a surprise. Anyone who had read a newspaper or attended a church service realized that the political and philosophical differences between the states up here in the North and those in the South were escalating so quickly that the country was essentially being torn in two. I saw the war coming, but I tried to hold it at bay for as long as I could. I did. Certainly, I believed in the preservation of the Union. And I believed in the abolition of slavery. I did. But I was a parent first, and I saw no reason why my boy had to join the fight at the sound of the first shot. I implored Georgie, "Georgie, wait. There'll be plenty of time for soldiering if this war persists." But Georgie wouldn't relent. He was determined to answer the call of President Abraham Lincoln. Desperate to protect Georgie, I decided to enlist as well. So I presented myself in front of the recruitment office and was promptly told that at 46 I was considered too old to fight. Barred from joining him, and unable to stop him, there was little I could do but wave as Georgie marched out of my sight with the 5th Connecticut Volunteer Infantry Regiment. I still tried to go to him, though. What else could I do? He was my son. 3 more times I presented myself to the recruitment office, and 3 more times I was sent home to wait and to worry. August 1862, 13 months after Georgie marched out of my sight, I received a letter that I had prayed would never ever find its way to me. Georgie was dead. He died at the Battle of Cedar Mountain, Virginia's Shenandoah Valley. He was positioned in the front lines, and his force encountered a Confederate force led by General Stonewall Jackson. The Confederates were twice the size and seized the day. The Army regrets my loss. He was only 19. In the days and weeks that followed, my receipt of that dreaded letter. I can't pull a clear memory. So awash in the anguish of not being there with my son. These unrelenting questions were swirling in my brain. What did he feel as he faced his enemy? As he faced his own death? Do I understand? What did he feel? What did he feel? It soon became apparent that in order for me to let Georgie go, I had to find him. Half mad with determination, I presented myself one more time in front of the recruitment office and was surprised to learn that the age restriction had been lifted. At 47, I enlisted in the newly formed 20th Connecticut Volunteer Infantry Regiment. My friends thought I was foolish or worse. My wife begged me not to go, but like Georgie, I would not relent. So clear was my purpose. I was outfitted with a blue woolen broadcloth uniform and introduced to a Springfield 1861 muzzle-loaded musket rifle. And off I went. Let me tell you, in the days and weeks that followed, I marched an awful lot. And if the road dust wasn't coming up to choke you, it meant you were slogging through mud. And mud ruins shoes. How Georgie must have suffered. In May 1863, my group had our baptism under fire. It was the Battle of Chancellorsville. We were pitted against a Confederate force led by General Stonewall Jackson. The Confederates were the superior force. Our unit suffered terrible casualties. We were forced to withdraw. The battle was a significant victory for the South. However, we began to hear reports that General Stonewall Jackson was mortally wounded during the battle. I took great pride in that, as if they were my musket balls that pierced his flesh, which caused his arm to be amputated, allowing him to die a slow death later due to the fatal pneumonia. But of course, that wasn't the case. Jackson was shot by his own men returning to camp. A scared sentry shouted the challenge, "Halt! Who goes there?" But, as encouraged by his major, didn't wait for the reply. The fact that the major was all of 23 years old makes Jackson's death much more somber. There was no heroic battlefield death for the great Stonewall Jackson. Perhaps this is what happens when we send scared boys out to fight our battles. Emboldened by the victory at Chancellorsville, the Confederates, Supreme Commander General Robert E. Lee, decided to invade western Pennsylvania with a goal to attack Washington from the virtually undefended north. Along the way, Lee's plans included the small village, for no strategic reason. But Lee had heard that this village had a shoe factory. Those southern boys were in desperate need of shoes. So on the morning of July 1st, 1863, Lee sent a scouting party out into the streets of this village looking for the factory. The scouts didn't find any shoes, but they did find a lot of Union soldiers. And what started as a skirmish became 3 days of chaos as two huge armies struggled in and around the streets of Gettysburg. On July 2nd, General Lee made a gross miscalculation. He believed that we had thinned the center of our lines up on Cemetery Ridge to reinforce our flanks. Therefore, he ordered a frontal assault. General George Pickett and his 15,000 men were ordered to advance across acres of open fields and to attack the center of our lines. The battle began with a huge artillery bombardment, but it was ineffective as it missed its mark. And as the smoke cleared, we could see this great gray wave of humanity emerging from the tree line, standing shoulder to shoulder, advancing at double crime across acres of open fields to our position, where our troops were fully entrenched with their 1861 Springfield muzzle-loaded musket rifles. Those boys didn't stand a chance. Oh, the few that made it to our lines were quickly captured. Over 6,000 died in the field that day. When we awoke the next morning, we discovered that the Confederate forces were gone. I don't know if we knew for certain, there certainly was a feeling that the tide of the war had turned in our favor. From my position up on Culp Hill, I leaned against the charred remains of what must have been a magnificent hickory tree, and I surveyed the field below. Grotesquely punctuated with gray, blue corpses. And all of their shoes had been pilfered. I felt the morning sun light upon my face, and I saw my shadow. And I instantly felt Georgie's presence. And I heard him say on the breeze, "Enough. Enough." I had done enough. I had found Georgie in the faces of the boys I'd marched with and I fought with, and whose hand I held as they lay dying. I had seen enough. I was nearly 50, but I felt like I was 100. Fortunately, my commanding officer released me from my enlistment and sent me home to Cheshire, where I lived until 1909. Dying as the oldest Civil War veteran, Connecticut's oldest Civil War veteran. The Civil War. The Civil War preserved the Union. Didn't preserve me, and it certainly didn't preserve Georgie. I hope and pray you folks never have to endure such a loss or witness such a war. And if you do sense a war brewing on the horizon, please, simply say, enough.